Okay, sorry for the quick break. I hope everyone's feeling resilient, but sustainable. We still have a lot of great stuff ahead. I just want to make two quick notes. One, I think it's very interesting that many of the government officials who are here today, after we broke up, are in another room actually working. And so I think this is one of the, I don't mean actually, what I mean is that they're, sorry. What I mean is, I'm glad we could contribute in this small way to just provide a venue for folks to come together, because as Jeannie was talking about, this is actually one of the most difficult things, which is to get the government coordination. I'm glad we're seeing some of that happening live as we're talking. And also, I just wanted to comment on some of the things from the last panel. You know, things have already changed. This is not just talk. In terms of, I myself am working on some waterfront things. I know, you know, someone who's here from Related on Hudson Yards. People are already starting to adapt, think about their projects differently, use different surfaces. Things are changing already, so I just want to give you that little piece of hope. I think I may be the person who's guilty of being the Dutch cheerleader. I was actually in Rotterdam with my students, the courtesy of the Dutch government, when Sandy hit. It was fascinating to be there. New Amsterdam has much to learn from Old Amsterdam, and so we're very pleased at the amount of Dutch representation that's here. The Consul General from the Netherlands is here, and I'm very happy to introduce our next speaker. Joos van Alphen, who flew in especially for this, is a special advisor to the Netherlands Delta Commission. Since 1984, Mr. van Alphen has served in a variety of positions in the Netherlands Ministry of Transport, Public Works, and Water Management. Since May of 2006, he has led the implementation of the EU Directive on Flood Risk Management, which is focused on the preparation of flood risk maps and management plans. From 2007 to 2008, Mr. van Alphen served as the Secretariat of the Committee on Sustainable Coastal Protection, where he advised on matters relating to long-term adaptation of the Netherlands to climate change. From 2009 to 2010, he served as the project leader for the development of new flood risk management standards in the Netherlands. Currently, he serves as the Dutch representative in a multilateral working group made up of the USA, the United Kingdom, Japan, and the Netherlands on risk-based flood management approaches. He graduated from Utrecht University in physical geography in 1983. Thank you very much for joining us today, Mr. van Alphen.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very honored to be here and tell you something about the Dutch experiences with flood risk management. Because, well, what I've heard is that there is a large demand for Dutch expertise in this region. but on the other hand, it might surprise you that the flooding of New York and the Sandy storm surge also attracted a lot of attention in the Netherlands. And that was not only because it was the election week. A flood abroad is always, for the Dutch people, a new signal to be aware of their vulnerability for flooding. So there's always a lot of attention. And for me and my colleagues working in flood protection in the Netherlands, it's always a good opportunity to learn from experiences abroad. And yesterday I had the opportunity to talk with some representatives of different administrations here in the New York region, and I was very impressed by the urgency in which they try to recover from the disaster and planning for the future and trying to build a resilient city. I think we can learn a lot of that from your experiences in the Netherlands. But on the other hand, of course, we have to offer you a lot of expertise, and that might help you in recovering sooner and better. And I hope this presentation contributes to that. So let me first start with some background information on the Dutch exposure profile. The Netherlands is a small country bordered by the North Sea. With some major rivers flowing through it, the River Rhine and the River Meuse, about 600 kilometers. Those rivers are international river basins, so we have a lot of coordination with other countries. 60% of our country is flood prone. That is on this slide indicated in the dark green and purple colored areas. And as you can see, the capital, Amsterdam, the A, the harbor of Rotterdam, the R, and the government city, The Hague, the H, are all situated in that flood-prone area. In addition to that, about 9 million people live in that area. 9 million of the about 60 million inhabitants in the Netherlands. On the annual base, we earn about 600 billion euros per year, to give you an idea of the economy. And you can imagine that with that economic values and that amount of inhabitants in a flood-prone area, we have very high protection levels. And that protection is delivered by 3,500 kilometers of flood defenses, hundreds of locks, sluices, and pumping stations. To give you an idea of the scale of the Netherlands, this small map on the left-hand side is New York, more or less at the same scale. So the area is smaller than the Netherlands, but I think the state of New York is much larger than the Netherlands. Well, when something goes wrong with these flood defenses, major floods might occur, and this slide gives you an idea of the maximum depth of flooding that might occur. This will not be the situation of a simultaneous flooding, but different parts might be flooded, and this map shows that depending on where you are, flood depths of about 3 to 4 to 5 meters might occur in the dark blue area, especially in the riverine area. This gives you an idea about the flood risk in the Netherlands compared to other risks. On the right-hand side are, for instance, a pandemic flu situation, a terrorist attack, electricity disruption. But on the left-hand upper side are the floods shown. By the Afsluitdijk, maybe you know it, 30 kilometers solid dike, and also development of the polders. But the most important thing from a flood protection perspective is that the former coastline of about 300 kilometers was reduced to about 45 kilometers. A similar approach was adopted after the floods of 1953 in the southwestern part of the Netherlands. The Delta Project was started, and again the tidal inlets and estuaries were closed by dams and storm surge barriers, like the Eastern Scheldt storm surge barrier and the Rotterdam Harbour storm surge barrier, shown in these two pictures. Dale told you already about it, and again. That resulted in a tremendous reduction of the coastline, formerly 750 kilometers and nowadays only 50 kilometers. So with those two projects, the coastline was in total reduced by about 900 kilometers. And you can imagine that it's very helpful to concentrate your flood risk on the areas that are left then. Many years the people in the Netherlands thought because of these projects we are safe against flooding. However, Katrina, New Orleans was for us, let's say, a kind of wake-up call because that showed that there is always a very small probability that dikes fail. And under those conditions, the damage and the fatalities and the disruption is catastrophic. Areas are without people left for years, and it takes years to recover from such a blow. So because of that, the policy of the Netherlands, which was mainly dominated by protection, was complemented with policies regarding damage reduction. So presently we have, let's say, a kind of threefold policy regarding flood risk management. Of course, the first one is protection. Floods in the Netherlands might be so devastating that our highest priority is to prevent those kind of floods from happening. But of course, we also try to reduce the damage when something goes wrong. And that is by spatial planning, land use planning, especially effective for new developments and for vital infrastructure and disaster management, like response and evacuation plans. Now, I'd like to go a little bit in detail on these kind of policy fields. Well, as I said, protection is the backbone of our flood risk management policy. We have a dedicated governance structure with strong administrative bodies on the central and regional level, like the water boards. And we have, in addition to that, a legal obligation to protect the Dutch citizens against floods. And that legal obligation is described in the Water Act. In that Water Act, there are legal standards for protection. They were developed in the 60s. It's also prescribed to have a periodic assessment every 6 years and to report the outcomes of the assessment to the parliament. So it's open to the public where the flood defenses are okay or where they have to be improved. Well, in a delta region, we experience that you are never ready with your flood protection works. That's because the delta is subsiding, the sea level is rising. So as a result of these periodic assessments and the report to the parliament, we have a kind of continuous flood protection program, and this is an example of a dike reinforcement in the river area where we have to deal with a very complicated situation of weak levees and buildings very close to it. Now, something about those standards. The standards for protection, they were developed in the 60s by the first Delta Committee, and they are based on a kind of cost-benefit analysis. This slide shows you on the horizontal X the increase of a dike, of a levee, and on the left-hand side, the vertical axis, the costs. There was a pointer over here, but not anymore. It's on the table. This increasing line from left low to the right upper side shows you that with increasing dike height you have to pay more investment costs. That's logical. The higher you build, the more you have to spend. This line drops when the dike height is increasing. The resulting damage is decreasing, of course. It's complementary. The higher the dike, the lower the residual risk. And what you are interested in is the costs when added to each other. And that's shown in this black line. And you can see that there is more or less a minimum. A minimum in which the cost of dike increasing doesn't outweigh anymore the damage that is avoided. And this situation is what we call the economic optimum level of protection. And that can be derived for every dike ring. It can be derived for every dike ring depending on its flood characteristics, but also its economic value, the assets, and the flooding probability. And in this way, the levels of protection in the Netherlands were determined, shown in this map. For the coastal area, indicated in red, a level of protection of 1 in 10,000 years was derived, and in the riverine area indicated green, the level of protection is about 1 in 1250 years. But as I said, those figures were derived in the 60s. In the meantime, the development of population and economic activity, might is aware that it would be a good idea to review those standards. And that's what we are doing now. And in addition to that, we also include the probability of fatalities because of a flood. Like here, but also in the Netherlands, fatalities due to floods are politically not accepted anymore. So we try to include that aspect also in the standards of protection. And in that way, we try to guarantee a kind of tolerable risk, a minimum level of tolerable risk for every citizen in the Netherlands, at a value of about 10 minus 5 per year. And well, we are now in a debate on a regional level where stakeholders, municipalities and water boards discuss on what level that new protection standards should be. In that discussion, also the second part of the flood protection strategies are involved, and that is the damage control by land use planning. We have made maps showing the speed of flooding and the depth of flooding. For instance, in this slide, you see on this axis the maximum water depth that might occur during a flood, and on this axis the minimum time of arrival of a flood. For instance, here you have a very deep flooding, more than 2 meters, but that develops gradually. It takes more than 24 hours. Whereas in this situation, you have a very shallow flooding, but that occurs very quickly. And that is important for the capability of an area to resist a flood or to recover from a flood, or to evacuate people for a flood. And especially flood depths between 0.5 meter and 2 meter, we think are very important for building codes. Because with proper building codes, we think that disruption can be reduced and recovery can be improved. So we try to plan measures in those areas for flood-proofing buildings and especially vital infrastructure and services. And of course, electricity has priority. Yesterday I heard from the people in New York that also the electricity was here very important. For instance, for people living in high-raised apartments because they couldn't get drinking water and use their elevators anymore. And it illustrates how dependent we are in present society on power supply. On the other hand, areas that might be flooded in a very shallow way, we think a policy should be implemented which is aimed at dealing with the flood, reduce the disturbance. And we think that can often be combined with strategies to deal with pluvial flooding. Pluvial flooding by rain might give similar problems as a shallow flood from a river, for instance. And that when you combine those strategies, that might be more efficient. Some examples of flood-proof buildings in the Netherlands. On the left-hand side, an example of an ICT and computing center in Lelystad, where the main computers and electricity is above this level. And this is an example of a new hospital that is developed in Amersfoort, in which also the vital services and the entrances are above the flood level. And this is the third part of our multi-level flood risk strategy. Well, I have very little to say about that because that is our weakest part. And as you can see, I have an image from the United States to illustrate what we mean with that. We have very little experience with that, and we hope we can learn about a lot of you on this topic. So that is about the present policy on flood risk management. Now let's have a view into the future. Future flood risk management. Well, like many deltas in the world, we experience sea level rise, and that might increase in the future. And maybe more extreme storms. And as a combination, that will give increased erosion of our beaches. From the other side, the main rivers will show an increased river discharge, especially in winter time, when less precipitation occurs as snow and more as rainfall. In summer, we experience already more often very heavy thunderstorms, giving high intensity of rainfall, let's say the pluvial flooding. In summertime, we expect decreased river discharges, and in combination with the higher temperatures, that will give a higher frequency of summer droughts and effects on agriculture. And with lower river floods in summer, the marine waters might invade more into the country, salt intrusion, and that might affect our inlet points for the drinkwater supply. And we subside, like many deltas in the world. It's a geological process, very little to do, to deal with. And in the same time, we continue with spatial developments in, let's say, the most dangerous part of our country. So against this background, the government established the Delta Commission, and in the same time we continue with spatial developments in, let's say, the most dangerous part of our country. So against this background, the government established the Delta Commission, which should be, which can be taken already now as a kind of no regret steps. And that plan, that Delta program, is developed in a multi-governmental setting. So all relevant administrations and authorities are involved as far as they are concerned with water management, municipalities, provinces, water boards, stakeholders, etc. Well, the Delta program is about the future, about the next century, and that means a lot of uncertainty. Uncertainty regarding climate change, but also uncertainty regarding social economic developments. And we think that uncertainty should not be an excuse to wait and see. We think uncertainty should be made more or less operational in decision making. And adaptive delta management is our way to make that uncertainty operational. The key is adaptive planning. Adaptive planning can be characterized in two ways. It's clear in your objectives, but flexible in the way to go. Like this old sailor vessel showed. It has a sail, but then when there is no wind, you can take the paddles. To deal with the uncertain future, we develop scenarios. And to deal with future decision making, we developed a strategy in which we use tipping points and specific adaptive strategies. First, something about the scenarios. In our situation, the main drivers for future flood risk and freshwater supply are climate change, which is on the horizontal axis, and socio-economic growth, which is on the vertical axis. And we combine a rapid climate change or a slow climate change with a rapid economic development or a declining economic development. And in this way, we developed four future scenarios. And we characterize them by STEAM, which is the worst case, high climate change and high economic development, busy, warm, and rest. And in those scenarios, we include our present knowledge on sea level rise, river discharges, rainfall and precipitation, but also socio-economic developments like population growth, economy, the effect which those developments will have on the land use pattern and urban developments and freshwater supply. These scenarios are used in a first step to establish when can we expect first our problems when we continue our present policies. In a second step, they might act as a kind of inspiration for the development of new strategies. And in the third step, they act as a kind of robustness test for the strategies we develop. In a way that we have developed such a strategy, but will it also be effective for another scenario? Well, some characteristics of those adaptive strategies. We think that it is important to keep future options open and to avoid a lock-in. And therefore, it is important to connect short-term decisions, for instance in the physical domain, with long-term water challenges. It is important to link with other investment agendas, for instance, the aging infrastructure. Aging infrastructure has nothing to do with climate change. On a certain time it is out of date, it has to be replaced, and then the question arises, do we replace it now or do we wait 10 or 20 years? Do we reconstruct it or do we build a complete new one? And how can we combine that with other developments? And an adaptive strategy is also able to speed up or slow down when climate change or socio-economic developments ask for that, and are also flexible to change to another strategy when that's necessary. So it's more or less trying to find a balance between too early, too much, versus too late or too little. For the short term, it's very important to derive where spatial reservations should be made. It's not necessary to prepare already very large capital investment programs, but to keep the options open, it's important to identify spatial reservations. Yeah. For instance, for future levee enforcement, for water discharge, storage and sand extraction. As an example of connecting short-term decisions with long-term water challenges, an example of the boulevard in Scheveningen, coastal protection work which has to be had to be accomplished. It consists of a hard core, hard dike, which is covered with sand, and it could be very well fitted into the urban development plans of the city of Scheveningen. And this is an example of a dike improvement in the Rotterdam harbor area, where the dike is rebuilt. A tunnel for traffic is included in it, and on top of it, a very attractive park for the public. Well, imagine this kind of approaches for instance, Coney Island or Battery Park. Regarding flexible measures, it was already mentioned, building with nature is our concept. This is an example of a very large beach nourishment program. 20 million cubic meters at once were deposited on the shore, and we expect that natural currents will transport the sand to other places. And of course other building with nature examples, I've seen them also from here, this area, like oyster reefs. The idea behind it is use the natural forces, the natural transports to transport the sand from one place to another, or to reduce wave action and to as a way of enforcing your dike profile. Well, as I said, climate change might also affect fresh water supply in the Netherlands, and that is integral part of our strategy development. For instance, because of the strategic water reservoir in the Netherlands, when we increase that water reservoir, then also the dikes have to be raised. When we want to have stability on the fresh water supply in the Rotterdam area, maybe we have to close the harbor of Rotterdam by a sluice complex. So I come to almost the conclusion of my presentation. Because, as I said, climate change adaptation and working in the Delta requires a long-term perspective and some prerequisites for future-proof implementation. So we prepare a Delta program containing the measures, which is yearly updated and presented to the Parliament. Within the multi-governmental role, we have a Delta Commissioner providing leadership, supervising coherence between the different regions. We have a Delta Fund containing about 1 billion euros per year. And we have Delta Act as a kind of legal base for the Delta Commissioner, the program and the fund. So this might be your traditional idea of Dutch flood risk management. And I hope that after this presentation, the new idea of Dutch flood risk management consists of, first, let's keep the enemy out, shorten the coastline, concentrate your flood risk strategies in a three-layered approach, develop protection standards based on a cost-benefit analysis, and maybe add to them the loss of life and societal disruption to it. Improve your damage control by spatial planning and breach-proofing the dikes, and prepare for an uncertain future by adaptive strategies and a sound institutional framework. And finally, learn from abroad, because as I said at the start of my presentation, all Delta regions in the world experience the same threats, and I think we all agree on the concepts, but we are looking for valuable experiences how to implement those measures. I thank you for your attention.